set up for church? Okay. Yeah, I'm on that other church. I like that, St. James. Yeah. I'm going to church. Talk to you. How you doing? You cool? Doing better?
Ladies and gentlemen, we have Seth Weinstein with us on the piano today, and we're very grateful that you're here with us. Oscar, we love you, and we know that you're sitting at home watching us right now, and you are one of our many congregation members who is just having a little bit of a bout with COVID, so throughout this COVID season. So we pray your strength and your return, and we're glad that you are with us on Zoom today. I see you there online with us. Chris Bozell is out of town, so we are going to be working together on the computer things. And I want to introduce to you someone who will be helping us with our slides and our computer technology today. His name is Stephen Smart, and we really want to ask that everybody has patience and grace because we're doing this together for the first time. As you can see, I wanted you to take a look at the front of the bulletin cover. Here today, our main scripture is actually our gospel lesson is the Good Samaritan. If you know, here in the United States, what you've been seeing lately are several people who are doing nothing more than whipping out their cameras rather than being a Good Samaritan. But I do want you to think about this young lady, Daniela Frazier. Daniela Frazier, who was 17 years old when she was taking her little niece to the grocery store. And she saw the policemen kneeling with their neck on George Floyd's neck. She was paralyzed with fear, didn't know what to do, didn't know how to help. And the only thing that she could do to help and be a Good Samaritan was to take out her camera. And it was that act of taking out the camera and that braveness in that moment that actually changed world history. So I just wanted to lift that up and have us not just forget that this bulletin cover is not just a wonderful piece of art, but that it speaks to our scripture and it speaks to our times. So with that, I'm going to move forward and hear our first psalm of the day, and I'm going to actually stop sharing the screen and turn the computer over, my computer over, to Stephen. And we thank you again for your service with us today. And others will help us to admit into the room when they come in. There you are, Stephen. So welcome to St. James Presbyterian Church here on the corner of 41st Street and St. Nicholas Avenue. Here we are. Village Harlem, the city of New York, glad to be here in presence with you and with God one more time, as they say. Let us now hear our psalm of the day, and notice that there is a blessed silence. That is the phrase we're going to see in the Bible. Selah. Selah is a musical transcription in the Psalms that very often many people say Selah, which is wonderful, but it's actually to denote a shift in the music and a shift in the character and the character's voice. So we take a great moment of silence to shift our mood. So hear now Psalm 82. God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. How long will you judge unjustly and show partiality to the wicked, you all? Give justice to the orphan and to the weak. Maintain the right of the lowly and the destitute. Rescue the weak and needy, and deliver them from the hand of the wicked. They have neither knowledge nor understanding, and they walk around in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. I say, you are gods, children of the Most High, all of you. Nevertheless, you shall die like mortals and fall like any prince. Rise up, O God, judge the earth, for all the nations belong to you. The commentary on this particular piece of scripture is that God is looking down on those who have been chosen to do justice and to settle judgments in the courts and found them lacking. Psalm 82. I now introduce you to the ruling elder on Jewish, who will be our liturgist for the day, and she will guide us through our liturgy and bulletin. If you see something in bold, please make sure that you read it out loud and say that with us. Even if our neighbors are sitting next door, that they can hear us loud and well. Ruling elder on Jewish, we will share the screen so that we will see our first call to worship.
Yes, good morning. Good morning. I hope everyone can hear me. Pastor Derek, it's a little bit difficult to hear you this morning more than usual. So I don't know whether you're standing far away from the mic, but I just asked that you step a little closer and I will speak up. And if I need, my sound needs to be boosted, you will be able to let me know that as well. By the way, I also hear some rustling of papers. That's, I don't know whether it's someone who needs to mute.
Is that okay?
I'll take care of that.
That's better.
Okay. Oh, I put the church service on. Oh, yeah. Yeah,
I'm soon. Yeah. Okay. Well, right. Good morning again. Good morning again.
Good morning. Ruling Elder Andre, please unmute yourself.
Yes, that's much better. Thank you.
Thank you for your grace, everyone.
But yes, thank you so much. As we come together, this is our community. And as we know, we work together to praise God and to move through this service as smoothly as possible. But we do appreciate your grace and patience. And so we move on with our service. As I was saying, I bring you greetings from Alabama, Huntsville, Alabama. And I am so pleased, and we are all blessed that we have this technology so that we can expand our community outside of the physical presence in the sanctuary. And so we move now into our call to worship, as you have on your screen for those of you on Zoom and in your bulletin. All-knowing God, you hear us when we thank you for the little things in life.
Now we come together to lift up our praise as a gathering of your people for love of you.
Let us bring our voices together and share how good God is.
This love we have for that turns our whispered thanks into echoing praise.
All nature joins with us in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love.
And we lift our voices to sing, pray, and tell our stories until the power of the Lord comes down. Our opening hymn is There Is a Wideness in God's Mercy, but it will actually be sung to the tune of Nettleton, which you will hear as a familiar tune when Seth starts playing.
There's a wideness in God's mercy. We adore God for that wideness and for God's grace. And we now enter into this time of prayer, and our first prayer shares that feeling of adoration for our God. Sovereign God, how excellent is thy name above all the earth. As much as you have set your glory above the heavens, you give us the glory on this earth. As to those who would destroy your creation, you use the mouths of babes and infants to build up your forces against her enemies and avengers. For out of the mouths of babes and infants, we hear the wonder of your majesty. It is through their oohs and ahs that follow their gaze into the moon and stars you have established. Who are we that you should care for us? And yet, still, you have given us dominion over all the earth, not to rule over or destroy it, but to care for it,
yes,
and to nurture it. We adore you today and all days, wonder-working God. Oh, sovereign God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. May it be so. Amen.
Amen. From
Pastor. Amen. Amen. You are the source of my life, my strength, my all. We continue with our prayers. We praise God. We have expressed how much we adore God and God's love and grace and mercy for us. But we also have a time when we have a chance to confess that we may have not lived up to what God knows we can be. And so we have this time of confession, our community confession. Our call says, in confessing together, we recognize that we are all equal in God's sight. Let us lift up our frailties to God together and open our hearts to speak to God in silence. We say our prayer of confession now together.
How many times have we walked by the poor wayfaring stranger, unwilling to look, stop, or even just to pray? How often have we been caught up in our own mess that we can't see the one who suffers, not worse, but in a different way? And how many times have we gotten stuck in our own rut, so much in pain that we dare not ask for help? Just how is this love of neighbor, love of self, love of God, expressed in our daily lives? Let us think about what John Calvin's words mean to us and know that we can be thankful because God does not look at what we do, but at what we ought to do, since it is impossible that in the weakness of this flesh, that perfect love can obtain its purest form in us. Help us, loving God, to clearly see what we ought to do and give us the strength to do it. Amen. Continue looking at this screen as you take a moment for our silent confession and bring your prayers to God. As you think about your silent confession in these words, hear this old song from the 70s that speaks so beautifully to our scripture today.
Thank you.
what a beautiful song. It's amazing how some of these old songs that did not come out of the church are just as meaningful in our thinking today, in the thinking about how we live, and it certainly is appropriate for our gospel today. We continue, though, in our prayer time in knowing that God pardons us. We are forgiven. We have said we're sorry. God says, I forgive you. We have that assurance of pardon. What joy it is to know that we can see ourselves the way God sees us through God's mercy and grace. From a good root, good fruits may grow. We are the fruits hidden in the bud. God sees that we can flourish.
Amen and amen.
Do you?
Can't nobody do me like Jesus? Oh, can't nobody do me like the Lord? Can't nobody do me like Jesus? Everybody officially and say welcome into the house of the Lord. Right. Welcome to St. James Presbyterian Church here on the corner of West 141st Street and St. Nicholas Avenue and the village of Harlem. I'm so excited from all of that. You have to forgive me a little bit. Yeah, we're going to keep this on the ledge because the microphone is with the camera, is with the computer, so that's how people are hearing me. But I wanted to thank you all for being with us today, and I wanted to explain a little bit about how the Holy Spirit works. My brother was born in 1971, and you'll hear a little bit more about that when I speak to the young people. But every time I heard that song as I was growing up, "He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother," I would break down in tears. So I break down in tears every time I sing that song because of the love that I have for my brother. So I'm not gonna say excuse me, I'm just letting you know why. So that's where we are today. There are not many announcements today except to say we want to keep some of our families in prayer, which are listed in your bulletin today. And I wanted to just highlight that I'm so glad that we put another family in here. I just have to find that. the Kilgore family is asking for prayer this week as well. They reached out this week and asked for prayer. And there are others as well that are asking for prayer. So we are grateful for that as well. And as we move forward, we want to remember all of those on our prayer list, including my cousin Candace Davis and all of those others, Phyllis Hope, Lorreen Edwards, Valerie Winter, so on and so forth. And I just want to give thanks to God for that. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We are grateful once again that we have Seth who is able to be with us. Yes. I don't know what you all know about Seth. Yes.
Abecedarian
walks. He's been walking through all of these islands around the world. And whoever knows when you're going to catch him. I get his daily log. It's a travel log when he's on the road. So if you see him on Facebook or you want to get on there and find out what's going on around the world, do log into that. But it's a wonderful thing. He just happened to be in the United States next 2 weeks. So it's great. An opportunity that we have to work with you again. And what a joy it is. So thank you for being with us. As always. Thank you so much. Yes. And we want to also thank you for your patience with us as we go through and work with our new computer technician here today. We're learning things as we go along with Stephen. And Harriet, I noticed that Tony has come in. If you need to speak with Harriet, you can speak with her. So we give thanks to God as well. So Harriet, you can check in with during the Peace of Christ to see if there's anything that's needed. All right, so God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. We're going to share our screen again to just go through a few of the announcements that we say every week, and we want to make sure that we have. And so with that, I want to let you know that we are at 409 West 141st Street and St. Nicholas Avenue, New York, New York, 10031-6400 or 6401, one of those two, you'll see it. And you're able to reach us by going to stjames409@horizon.net. All of this is online and all of this is also in your bulletin. But we're trying to make sure that everybody can hear and all learn in all these different ways. Some of us learn by hearing. Some of us learn by seeing. Some of us learn by touching. So we want to try and figure out all the different ways that people can learn where we are and who we are and what we're doing. And if you would like to reach me personally, I can be reached at pastor141@horizon.net. That's pastor141@horizon.net. Once again, it's just pastor, the street number, @horizon.net. We try and keep things easy around here as well. So we wanted to thank you. And I also wanted to let you know that if you go to our website at www.stjamesharlemnyc.org, you'll be able to see that as you scroll down the page that there's a PayPal button, a yellow PayPal button. And if you would like to give donations and offerings, you can do so. And you can do so through that medium. We also want to let you know that on our first Sundays and all throughout the month, you can designate where you would like your offering to go. You can designate it to the parapet wall, which we only have $8,000 left out of a $73,000 bet budget. And I think that deserves a great amen, because during a pandemic, St. James did not go into debt while raising $73,000. Yes. God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. That's a feat that we've been able to do that. I also want to let you know that I was also going to say that you can donate to our music and worship. You can donate to our scholarship fund. You can donate to our, what was that last one I wanted to say? Deacons!
Yes!
Deacons! Every month, they collect their monies and they do work in the community. And when they use your offerings to do that, and it goes directly out into the community, as well as donations and offerings for Thanksgiving for God and what God has done in your life, and also to support the ministries of St. James Presbyterian Church. Now, there's a saying in our bulletin today that I'm going to twist my head so that I can see it on the screen, from my mom to you, as you can go back one slide. There we are. It says, bravery is not the absence of fear. Bravery is feeling the fear, the doubt, the insecurity, and deciding that something else is more important. Bravery is not the absence of fear. For bravery is the feeling, it's feeling the fear, the doubt, the insecurity, and deciding that something else is more important. For Mark, Manson, and Arthur. Think about that. We were talking yesterday in our session meeting about some of those times when God gives us that strength even in the midst of our fear. And we don't know what we're doing, but we just step out on faith. So faith also equals bravery. Thanks be to God. Let us move to our next slide, where we will share with you that we have Bible study every Monday evening. We even had it on July 4th. Monday evening from 6 to 7:30. Our lectionary scriptures are in the bulletin and online here. You see them. We will be moving forward through the book of Amos. Well, Amos, what a prophet. When we were studying it this week, I was like, oh my word, he does not play. So we are going to continue with Amos. Our psalm will be 52. Our reading will be from Colossians chapter 1, 15 through 28. And our gospel will be continuing through the book of Luke, chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. That is it. We're going to move out of here because it's warm out and it's a beautiful summer day. And God wants us to worship not just in that sanctuary and with our song and with our praise, but God wants us to worship by looking up at this beautiful summer day and saying, thank you, God, for the miracles and the magic that you do every day around us. So we're going to acquiesce to God's design and God's will to be praised by looking at the trees and looking at the sun, by getting out of here early. Oh, how's that?
Great.
Amen. Amen. So now we're going to move to our next slide, because it's now that time for what we used to say was ruling Elder Andrea Bradford's favorite part of the service, but she has so many now. So this is yet another one of Andrea Bradford's favorite part of the service. After we give thanks to our liturgist, who is Andrea, we want to give thanks. He's now on our slide, Stephen Smart. We want to give thanks to ruling Elder Chris Bozell. And we also want to give thanks to ruling Elder Oscar Maxwell, and thanks for his health. And we want to give thanks to Seth Weinstein. And we want to thank you for your service. Because you share your gifts with love, dedication, and honor. And it is a joy to partake with all of you. And we want to thank our security. We want to thank our bulletin manufacturer. I will say this to you all. People have been wondering what it's like to go back into church after a pandemic. I know many of you are going to be staying home, and we'll keep doing this for time immemorial as long as the electricity works. That's not a problem. But I want to let you know that we are moving back into some sort of a sense of rhythm. So having a team of people and pointing them out is a huge blessing, because there's been a lot that's gone on behind these closed doors, and now that people are finding their niches in ministry, you can feel the energy in this space and the responsibility that people have, because it's not just volunteering, it's not just a job you do, it's just not something the pastor is asking you to do. It is a personal ministry. And I've always asked, since I started here as intern in 2015, for everyone to look in your heart and see what you're doing and see how God is calling you to ministry. Your work, your gifts are ministry. So we thank you, and we look forward to filling up the place with ministries as we move forward. As St. James used to be, if you look in their bulletins, Sister Antoinette will tell you, they had guilds and ministries, so many that we couldn't even keep count of, right? We may not get to that number, but we're going to get back. So Sister Antoinette Trainer has been a member here for birth. I was going to say a long time, but I'm just going to say birth. And she is reminding us that there used to be a Tompkins Memorial Luncheon named after Pierce Butler Tompkins, the founder of St. James Presbyterian Church, who fought for another African-American church to be recognized in the Presbyterian of New York City. We're praying for you wherever you're going. God bless you. And she remembers this Tompkins Memorial Luncheon that was used as a fundraiser. Every guild sort of did something to raise money for the church. And she remembers they had printed menus. There were three or four gentlemen in the congregation who had restaurants in Harlem, and they would do all of the cooking. And even when she thought that she was going to get away from helping out when she went to college and she came back, she said, okay, I'm going to hang out with my friends. She said, no, you're not. You're not too old to serve. So she had to come here and put on her little waitress thing and still come and help serve the luncheon. And that's a ministry for the church. And these are the memories that community are made up of. And she was saying that she found one of those menus in her possession. It was on her nightstand and she keeps forgetting to bring it. But thank you for sharing that history with us and that ministry with us as well. There are a lot of different ministries, and we'll be talking about those as we move forward. So many different things. So many different things. Thanks be to God. Let us move now to our next slide. Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford.
Yes, yes. It's so nice to hear about some of the history of St. James. What a glorious place it was with that the luncheon and all the various ministries. And we now respond to where we are, and we go out into the park, and Pastor, you sit on the stoop of the church, and all of those things that we now do that respond to the immediate needs. Especially during this COVID time, hopefully the ends, but the COVID time nevertheless. So we now get a chance to share a little bit with one another. We get to share some love through the peace, sharing the peace of Christ. It says the peace of Jesus is a balm in Gilead to the poor wayfaring stranger. It is also the healing for the sin-sick soul. May this peace of Christ be with you forevermore.
And also with you. This is an opportunity for you to press your space bar and get off of mute, or press star 6 if you're on the phone. And we're going to share the peace of Christ with one another. This is your break.
Oscar, peace of Christ, brother.
How you doing?
Good. How you feeling?
Good. I'm feeling good.
Good, man. Good. Good. You're stressed up.
Hey, Oscar. Peace of Christ, Andrea.
Hi, Shelby.
Hey, student.
Christ, Brenda.
Now we get $5 for each.
What was that, Brenda?
Now we get $5 for each day.
You gotta take out a loan. Now they have a party in the sanctuary.
Don't even have Boris fans here.
People are paraded by the cameras.
Thank you.
Praise be to
Feels weird to be on this side.
Yeah, how about that? All
right, be surprised.
Hi, Gloria.
Hi, Phyllis.
Yeah. It's a little stronger. I gotta go get this shot.
We are going to miss you, but we are so grateful for the time that you spent here with us these past few weeks, and we give thanks for you. You've been singing along, you've been praying along, and it's been really beautiful. Thank you for joining us for the month. It's been so good to have you here with us. And don't forget, we're on Facebook, Zoom, and on YouTube, so we'll still be around.
Pastor, I mentioned it too, or the next week is the last week. Maybe mm-hmm. we can get a group photo.
We'll get a group
photo. Does that sound like a plan?
Sounds like a plan to me. That's just Rick taking care of his business. So as we're moving forward, I want us to think about, now that we're on this idea of helping, and we're thinking about helping as ministries, let's just lift up also and never forget that we have a wonderful woman who is online, who calls up and who called up this week, who said, I just want to check on the security of the church after that church was robbed in the Bronx. Deacon Cora Gilmore. Let's not forget that she spearheaded and helped the deacons to also do a feeding program out of St. James. Before feeding programs were in fashion, as it were, it was a duty and a ministry that was felt by deacons and Cora Gilmore to make sure that that happened out of St. James. So we never want to forget those who are with us who we want to lift up and give praises to. As a matter of fact, if there's a ministry or something that you've done in St. James's history that you would like to share with us, please send us a note and send it to where? 409 West 141st Street, St. Nicholas Avenue, New York, New York, 10031-6400, and we'll be lifting it up as we move along. We have so many ministries, and we want to continue to remember them, especially if you were a vital part of them. So thank you. Thank you, Sister Traynor. Thank you, Deacon Gilmore. Thank you, everyone in here, because I know you're all busy with ministries as we speak now. God bless you. And now let us bless Ruling Elder Andrea Bradford for her incredible ministry of liturgy as we share the screen once more so that we can move into our scriptures.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you. It takes a Christian village. Amen.
Amen.
And we are all worshiping together. We are in community together to build the kingdom. And so we move on now into our time of reading the word, getting our inspiration, building our strength through the word.
Amen.
We have a prayer that leads us into this time. It is our prayer of illumination. You have it there. Will you read it with me? We pray
for revelation of your truth for our lives to be exposed, sweet Jesus, as we read these words. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We have three scriptural passages this morning. The first is from the book of Amos. Pastor, you talked about how great Amos was. And we get a chance to read from the Bible, the book of Amos, chapter 7, verses 1 through 17. Amos 7, 1 through 17. This is what the Lord God showed me. He was forming locusts at the time the latter growth began to sprout. It was the latter growth after the king's mowings. When they had finished eating the grass of the land, I said, O Lord God, forgive, I beg you. How can Jacob stand? He is so small.
Ruling in our hearts, Bradford.
Yes.
Are you reading Amos 7, 1 through 17, 7 through 17?
I am.
About the plumb line?
Yes, I'm getting there. Verses 1 through 17.
Verses 7 through 17.
Verses 7 through 17.
From where you are. That's okay. I just wanted to make sure I was right. I mean, yes. I wasn't confused. That's all.
All right. Chapter 7, verses 7 through 17. This is what he showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, said to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words, for thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go, flee away to the land of Judah, earn your bread there, and prophesy there. But never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary, and it is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet, nor prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, go, prophesy to my people Israel. Now, therefore, hear the word of the Lord. You say, do not prophesy against Israel, and do not preach against the house of Isaac. Therefore, thus says the Lord, your wife shall become a prostitute in the city, and your sons and your daughters shall fall by the sword, and your land shall be parceled out by line. You yourself shall die in an unclean land, and Israel shall surely go into exile away from its land. And our second reading. From Colossians, the first chapter, verses 1 through 14, Colossians 1, 1 through 14. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ in Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Jesus Christ and of the love that you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. You have heard of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that has come to you. Just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard it, We have ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, as you bear fruit in every good work and as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And the gospel reading, according to Luke, the 10th chapter, verses 25 through 37. Luke 10, 25 through 37. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him. And when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him. And when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these 3, do you think, was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. When we come back after hearing our special music and speaking with our young people, I'm going to ask you if you would meditate and pray with me on the sermon title, "The Blessing of Caring." The Blessing of Caring. But before we do that, let's move to our next slide. The next slide, and you'll see on this slide, and for those of you who are here in the sanctuary, there's a young girl holding her baby sister, her infant baby sister. And I've titled this, "Ain't Heavy, That's Your Brother, Your Sister." And I wanted to talk to our young people about why I broke down in tears throughout that song. When I was 6 years old, my brother was born. And you heard me talk about my brother Aaron before. And you may have heard some of this story, but I've never told it completely like this before. My grandmother died before I was born, so I had an aunt Dot, and Aunt Dot was like the grandmother to the family. Well, my brother was born on June 9th, 1971. So at about June 16th or 15th, because he was a big baby, he came home and the entire family came over to our apartment. Aunt Dot had made everybody come over to the house. She made everybody come over to welcome Aaron home from the hospital. This was one of the things that she did. Usually we did it at Aunt Dot's house at 249 Martin Luther King in Marstown, but we did it at 10 Monroe Street this time, our house, our apartment. And so Aunt Dot told everyone to clear away from the corner of the room. My dad had a closet and an armchair, and she moved everybody away, and she said, "Derek, come here." And I went up to Aunt Dot, and she sat me down in the chair, and she told my mother, "Put the baby in his arms." And so my mom put my brother in my arms, and I'm sitting in this chair, and my Aunt Dot said, "Look at him." She said, "Forget everybody else in this room, look at him." She said, "This is your brother, and you are his brother. He will never know any other kind of love as strong as you have for him. Mama may go, Daddy may go, I may go, but your brother will always need you, Derek, and you will always need your brother. Hold him and caress him while we say this prayer." And then she prayed this prayer that got even the heathens in the room crying and saying amen and calling on the Holy Spirit. And as she said amen, she looked down at me. She said, "You understand what I mean?" And I thought, "I've loved this boy ever since I thought he was even going to be born. This is one of the most special times in my life." She said, "Remember it. Remember it." So when I talk to you all about "He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother," and I sing that song, that song came out at about the same time my brother was born. That's why it makes me emotional. And I tell you this story not just because I want you to understand how important my brother is to me. Yeah. But I learned something really important for my life in that moment. Is that when you make a connection with someone, and you make a connection in which you say your burden, you don't have to carry alone. Just a few weeks ago, Amon was in here singing, "You've Got a Friend," word for word. But when you have that understanding about how powerful a relationship is that God wants us to have with one another, just as I love my brother, God wants me to learn how to love every person I encounter. For us to learn how to be one another's brothers and be one another's sisters, just like Aunt Dot prayed for on that day so many years ago. So young people, what I'm trying to say to you is that you have a special gift to go out into the world and understand that we can be there for one another. We'll think about it in different ways as we get older. Maybe it's helping the homeless. Maybe it's working for a feeding kitchen. Maybe it's becoming a teacher. Maybe it's becoming a doctor. But I pray this for you today, that whatever you do in your life, that it manifests in the love of your brother and sister as if they were your very own baby brother or sister that you're holding in your arms for the first time. Because that's how precious humanity is. And that's just how God loves us. And more importantly, it's just how God loves you. Most gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for the beauty and the love and the joy of knowing And even though it seems as if our sisters and brothers' burdens are too heavy to carry, that they don't have to carry them alone, that we can help lighten the burden. And that by doing that, we build a community. We show people that even in the midst of adversity, that love still reigns supreme. And we thank you because our young people have this gift naturally. May they hold on to it and keep it and not get disappointed when they aren't rewarded for it, but to know that God's reward is the best of seeing their brothers and sisters thrive in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Stop sharing. Hezekiah Walker says, "This is my testimony, how God favored me in spite of my enemies." He says, "If God did it for me, He'll do the same thing for you. Don't worry about your haters, because your haters can't do anything with you. And I'm a living proof and testimony, as are you."
My integrity, my faith in God,
will not fall, will not bend, won't compromise. God favors me. I speak life and prosperity, and I speak health. God favors me. They whispered, conspired, they told their lies. God favors me. My character, my integrity, my faith in God, He favors me. Will not fall, will not bend, I won't compromise. He favors me. I speak life and I speak health, and you know God, He favors me. Say yes, 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 He favors me. Say yes, just yes, say yes, oh yes, God favors me, yes. Favors me. They'll attack your character and your integrity, but don't worry, no, God favors me. Yes, 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 God favors me. Yes, 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 God favors me. I don't know if any of you have ever been down and out with people walking by you and wonder, how is somebody going to even look at me? And then you realize that God favors you and somebody stops and comes by. Sweet. All of the songs, all of the music, all of our prayers have been focused on this idea of what it means to stop and love your neighbor, to do something for somebody else. But I wouldn't be a Presbyterian minister if I didn't think about doing some teaching of the text, right? We hear the story of the Good Samaritan and we boil it down to, well, these church folk walked by the poor, pitiful man because they had to get some business to do in Jerusalem, giving them the best. You know, giving them the best of their intentions, that they had to get to work, to the temple. The priest had to go be a priest. The Levite had to go light the candles in the temple, whatever. And then that there's this Good Samaritan, just this person going the other way who happens to stop by and help. Well, let me give you some of the background that Jesus is talking about here in Luke. This scribe that is testing Jesus is a lawyer. Scribes and Pharisees are part of the same thing. They interpret the law. They interpret the law and this oral law, because there's the Torah, which is the written law that everybody goes, that everybody follows and has followed for years. But because now they've been dispersed in a diaspora, not everybody can get to the temple. So the Pharisees sprung up, this other class of people who said, we'll interpret the law for you and tell you how to do it in your own home. So they were traveling around telling people, oh, you can't eat those buds that are coming up, even if you're starving, if it's on a Sabbath, you can't do that. And why are you doing this? It's a Sabbath, you can't do that. You are breaking God's law. So they're doing all of this. And it was only, I think, maybe about 6,000 to 8,000 Pharisees in the entire time. So they weren't that large of a class, yet they had great power. So this scribe is sent to Jesus, who we know Jesus is always tested by the empire and also by the Jewish rulers, the people of Israel at the time, because he's talking about things and he's sort of debating the law, and the Jewish community of leadership is saying, we got to test you because you are saying some things that we don't quite agree with because of the way that we're running things. So Jesus says, you know, tell me, you want to get into the kingdom of heaven. What is the law? What does the law say? And he quotes him, you know, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your might, and all your mind, all your soul. This commandment is also, it's found in Exodus, and it's also found in Deuteronomy. The second and the last book of the Torah. The Torah is where the law was handed down to Moses. Deuteronomy is the second reading and the second writing of that to encapsulate everything so that people can go on to the promised land with all of their laws and their culture intact. So he adds, and love your neighbor as yourself, which we know from a while back. Jesus has done the same thing with someone else who has tested him. Love your neighbor as yourself is something obscure that they pull out of Leviticus. And he tacks it on. And Jesus said, you've answered correctly. You've answered how I've been answering to everyone. You've answered how I've been pushing us to push everyone to think about what it means to love God with all your heart, your mind, your body, mind, soul, and spirit, including our neighbor and ourselves. Yes, very good. Then this Pharisee's got to push it. This scribe has got to push it. He wants to justify himself in front of everyone that's out there and says, well, who is my neighbor? Why does Jesus use a Samaritan in this? Let's go back to Amos. Amos is talking about prophesying. Amos is from the northern kingdom of Israel. No, the southern kingdom, where Judah is in Jerusalem. And the northern kingdom, they split after Solomon. So in the northern kingdom, there's this other kingdom, and they don't go to Jerusalem. What they do is they declare Bethel, Mount Bethel, the place where God is to be worshipped. And you hear in the book of Amos that he's saying that this is the king's place that the king has designed for worship. And so we don't hold the same place as being holy. Well, this whole, even after Israel came back together, Bethel in the northern kingdom, that's in Samaria. So there is this rub against these people who live in the north still and still worship at Bethel and don't recognize Jerusalem as the place where we are to worship. So this is the kind of thing where Amos is chastising Jeroboam and saying, no, you're going to fall and you're going to fail. You're not doing as we have been told to do. And I am not some professional prophet. I was minding my business, taking care of my cattle, and God spoke to me and I just had to speak. So don't put me in a category with all those other people that are trying to make money being a prophet. I'm here because God told me to tell this to you. And if you notice, the priest says that the words are coming from Amos, not coming from God. Amos says, I'm here to speak the words of the Lord. So we have this rub, this friction that is going on between the Samaritans and the Samaritans now, who we call the Samaritans, because they're really the same people that were in the northern kingdom who are worshiping in Bethel. Last week, we heard that Jesus was going to Jerusalem and he passed through Samaria, but they wouldn't help him because he was on his way to Jerusalem because Jesus thought Jerusalem was holy and the Samaritans didn't think it was holy. So they were like, I'm not going to help you. So Jesus says there was a Samaritan on the road. So when this scribe hears that there is a Samaritan on the road, he is thinking all these things about this guy. How we learn to dislike our own kind. Over years and years of undisputed and internal hatred is what is being witnessed here. We know it. African Americans know it. There was a time when if you were lighter skinned, and some say still even now, that you looked down on darker skinned people. There was a time when if you were Irish, of Irish descent, you looked down upon Polish people who came to New York City before and during World War II. Jerry Stiller, the gentleman I worked for, the comedian, wrote this biography, and that was one of the most incredible notice things that he noticed growing up in the Lower East Side, is that every single immigrant group, whether they looked alike or not, once they moved out, they found a way to be prejudiced and hate the people that had moved out. We do that with one another. So even some of us who say, well, I live in this part of Harlem, or I live in this part of the Bronx, or I live in this part of Manhattan, I don't live in that part. It's these false dichotomies that we bring up about one another that is being brought up about this very Samaritan, which is why Jesus says the priest went, the Levite went, and the Samaritan who was going in the other direction stopped. Why did Jesus choose Jericho Road? Seth, I'm sure you may have walked this road before, right? Or may have at least seen it. It's a 2,500 foot drop to 820 feet on this road, right? And so the robbers would hang up inside those cliffs and they would pounce on people as they were going through these winding roads from Jerusalem to Jericho, Jericho to Jerusalem. It was one of the most dangerous roads. And yet, the Samaritan stopped. He could have left the man to die, but he stopped. Because he was what? Not just kind, not just having pity. He also understood the importance of loving your neighbor as yourself because he had the same laws. So here, let's bring this to the 20th century. He stopped. He had a nice car. He may have had a BMW. He stopped his BMW and he took this bloody and beaten man and put him on the white interior of his BMW and drove him to a mid kind of hotel. Let's say, well, you know, not a motel, but a hotel, because he knew that he would need care, need to be taken care of. So he drops 2 denarii and says, I'll be back. 2 denarii in the first century is enough to keep someone in a hotel for 3 months. I did the calculations for now. A cheaper hotel is $6,000 in New York City. A mid-level hotel is $12,000 to keep somebody for 3 months in New York City. This man drops that money like nothing. He says, I'll be back, and if you need more, I got it for you. We love to talk about this story that Jesus tells, for it is a story, it's not factual. He tells them a story to prove a point. But it's important for us to understand the context of this story, because we so often go through these moments in our life and don't think about the context and the bigger picture of what it is that we're doing and what it is that we're encountering. And I want us to look at our scriptures to see very directly how they relate to our lives. This was somebody that he didn't have to help, but he did. This is what it means to actually love your neighbor. This is what it means to actually put yourself out and put somebody on your donkey or your horse so that it slows down your journey and you walk in the dangerous spot as well. You picking somebody up bloodied in your car and taking them to the hospital. You get a chance, there's an opportunity that if you are a certain ethnicity or in a certain neighborhood, you're gonna be blamed with causing the harm. But to still do right in those moments, to still do right when we are in danger is a very difficult thing for us to encounter, and very encounter in our own spirits, I mean. Jesus is testing the limits, not just saying being nice and, oh, taking care of someone. This is a very practical situation of life and death. life and death. And someone stops and helps. Now, we may end the story there, but the people in Bible study pushed me to make sure I brought this up. I may say to you, yes, now go forth and help the stranger. Love your neighbor. You see somebody suffering, pick them up, take them somewhere, get them some help, take them to a restaurant, even if they do smell, sit down with them and eat with them and talk with them about how you may be able to show them some love of God. Yeah, I could do all of that, but you all know all of that. You all know the things that you're capable of doing inside your own heart and your own body to help your neighbor and to love your neighbor. You all know that. We are all works in progress and just need to ask God to help us move on what we know that we can do. Because not all of us can do it right now, but that's okay. That's what grace is. God helps us to grow, to learn, to be better, so that when the opportunity arises at the right time, we can be there in the right moment. Be satisfied that God has a purpose for you. And if we all lived our purposes and followed our own love of our neighbor for just ourselves and how God is working with us, we don't have to do it all. I don't have to worry about the starving children across the country or around the world, because somebody around them will say, my goodness, I can't stand to see the fact that there are kids who cannot eat during the summer because they aren't going to school. So I'm going to make sure that they have food this summer. And then there's somebody else who's going to say, you know, it's really unfair that there are people during a pandemic who are afraid to go to the doctor or even a clinic to get tested for COVID because they're afraid that they're going to get identified as being homeless or identified as something else, and they don't have the money to deal with what they need to, and they're going to get sucked up into a system. And yet, we have the ability to figure out how to make that healthcare access. Somebody may have that knowledge. We have all these little things that we can do. And if we all were to put our gifts together, can you imagine? We don't have to bear the heavy load if we all bear a little bit. Caution. Just because you're a do-gooder, or just because you love your neighbor, doesn't mean that you have to fall down by the wayside too. One of the most important things about this story that Jesus tells is that this Samaritan drops him off at the hotel. I'll be back. Doesn't stop doing his business, doesn't stop living his life. He knows that God helps those who help themselves. That person has to sit there and figure out how to get better, and they have someone to help them. They got to get back on their feet. And this is a very real, real issue. So many of us, we pull ourselves down when we help others. And we don't have to do that. God is not calling. God is calling for us to be a witness, to be attended, and to work with him. But God is also calling for us to take care of ourselves. If you can't love yourself, what good is loving your neighbor more than yourself? What good is it to get caught up in a trap where you are opening your doors to a family member or a friend that is abusive to the system, that is abusive to you, and saying, well, God says I got to open my doors because that's the Christian thing to do? No, the Christian thing to do is to recognize that your safety and your health and your well-being is just as important, and that you can't help, as RuPaul says, how in the world are you going to help somebody else and love somebody else if you don't love yourself? This is a delicate balance we're talking about here. But this is why we have to stay in relationship with God. This is really what Christ is trying to say to the scribe. He's not chastising him. He's not judging him. He's saying, then go do it. Go do it. And I like to translate that into, go figure it out how you can grow to make yourself this kind of person. There are people in my life who I have felt so bad because I thought I was saying no to their faces when God was telling me to help. But then I realized that I put things in place, if I can put things in place to get that person to a better place, then I'm doing what I can. One of the 12 steps in 12-step programs is to say, I'm sorry and make amends. And in those times in making amends, someone called me up out of the blue once and said, I used you to get to this end, and I want to make amends, and I want to say I'm sorry. I say, I recognize your 12th step, your step that you're taking. But let me tell you something about me. I set up the opportunity for you to succeed. Whether you succeeded or not was on you. You didn't put me out. I just made a road clear for you. And you decided not to take that road. You didn't pull the wool over my eyes. You pulled the wool over your own eyes. And when you failed, you actually got the help you needed. That's dropping someone at the end and saying, I'm going off to do my business and I'll check back. The Samaritan teaches us how to love our neighbor. But I also want you to know that the Samaritan teaches us how to love ourselves, how to take care of ourselves. Self-care is one of the commodities in this country and in this world that is the most underrated. Why do you think I tell you to go outside and look at the sun and walk in the breeze? Yes, the glory of God will embrace you. But in doing that, do you realize that there are 5 minutes that you aren't focusing on what's wrong with the world or what's wrong with your life? There are 5 minutes that you are getting vitamin D from the sun and that your entire body calms itself down so that you can move forward into your next event or the next thing that comes on in your life? Ministry, from my perspective, would not be ministry if I didn't urge you to take care of yourselves, to love yourselves. Because then you love yourself and you love God. God reveals how you can love your neighbor. This is the blessing of caring. When you care, you are blessed immeasurably. Not simply by getting richer or getting more things or getting adulations, but the blessing of caring means that you are walking closer with your divine purpose and that you have cared for yourself. The blessing of caring means that you understand that you are a blessing. Hashtag the blessing of caring means that you recognize that you are a blessing. If that don't make you feel good, calm your spirit and calm your heart. Let that be what we take away from Jesus saying, go and do likewise. Go bless and care so that you can recognize the blessing you are. Yeah, that's how the Holy Spirit's calling us to be today in this sermon. And I say thanks be to God. Most gracious and loving God, we come to you now, having taken apart these scriptures and looked at some of the historical notions of it and taken apart some of the prejudices that we've had over these texts. and just to look at the kernels and the truth as it exponentially relates to us in our lives. For you are an exponential God. You take the seed of wisdom and the seed of truth and you let it grow inside of us. We ask that you take the kernel of this truth of the goodness in this story of the Good Samaritan, not just for helping someone that somebody else wouldn't so that we could blame others, but focus on the fact that somebody said, if I can help somebody along their way, then my living would not be in vain. May we go and do likewise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our congregational hymn of today is one by our favorite Fanny Crosby. Remember this blind woman from the 1800s who wrote all these beautiful hymns that we never recognize as a blind woman from the 1800s? Think about her as she sings and as she wrote this particular song when she said, "Pass me not, O gentle Savior." We can move to the next slide and share the screen.
Do not pass.
sounded mighty pretty today. And I'm sure you all are too at home. Amen, amen, and amen. And as we stop sharing our screen, we want to invite you to put your prayer requests in the chat. Even if you make a comment on YouTube after I edit this and put it there, we will look at those and we will add those to our prayer list and to our prayer concerns. And if you put something in the chat today, be for sure that if I don't mention it today, that I still have my jar of cocoa butter sitting on my nightstand to rub onto my knees when they get sore from praying. But I do use the cocoa butter and I do pray over these prayers. So let us make sure that we put our prayers in the chat and put them on Facebook and also put them in YouTube, and let us pull our hearts and minds together and think about those things that are resting on our heart. Just take a moment to silently think about what's going on in the world. Think about what's going on in North America. Think about what's going on in the United States. Think about what's going on in New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, wherever you're watching this from, right around and outside your door. And then go inside your door and think about the things that you need for God to hear about you and your family and your friends. And with all of that, if you can't find something to bring to God, you can still say thank you, Lord. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for waking us up this morning and letting us take that first inhale and that first exhale that consciously told us that we are alive. You had the mercy to allow us to see another day, not just because we woke up, but because you have new things for us to see and experience. May our soul, spirit, body, and mind take in all that you offer us today. From the cool breeze in the warm day, to the sip of cold water later this afternoon that we'll take and say, oh, that was just right. To the smile and delight that we see in kids running up and down the street and playing basketball in the parks. To somebody who's going to say, I don't know, I think I want to grill today. Let's invite some people over and build community and family. Gracious God, we thank you for all of these things and so many more that we cannot name. We also thank you for the wonderful way in which our young people are moving about their lives, doing well on their exams, testing far above what everyone is expecting of them, what the world is expecting, and then blowing those results off the roof. We give thanks for that, oh God. We give thanks for our basketball team and for our young people who are playing football, who played yesterday two games. We give thanks also, God, for all these parents who are looking at their children, be they young children, be they adult children, and may they have a moment and an opportunity to say, thank you, God. And just as those parents do that, may we children also take a moment, whether our parents are with us or not, physically on this plane, have a moment of gratitude for all that they have done for us. Whether we are in good relationship or good standing now, help us to remember the good moments that brought us an understanding that your love can be reached. And God, we know that there are many people in this world who do not feel loved. As we see on the news, people that are going after their quote-unquote ops, just raising guns like they're in a video game, not realizing that they are actually taking lives, God. We don't ask for political well-being, God. We ask for your theological grace to be upon this world. We don't ask for gun control just to make people happy and to make Democrats and Republicans fight. We ask for it because we want to save lives, oh God. We don't talk about Supreme Court rulings simply because to be on one side or the other. We pray for the 10-year-old in Ohio who had to go to Indiana in order to have a procedure because she was raped by someone. God, we ask you to touch this, our people. May we help others love one another as themselves. And God, we see those headlines and those things that we try to depoliticize and ask for your guidance and your grace. Some may disagree with what we speak about and what we pray for, but that's not the issue either. The issue is simply that you will bring your presence into our lives and your wisdom into this world and your guidance into how we move forward into the future. That is our prayer, O God. As the people believe or agree with how we do it, we know that if we give the power to you and the control to you, that you will help us to do what is right in your will. Not because we are claiming it to be right, but because you are showing us and guiding us in the right direction. May we be Christians in our hearts, not because we are a quote-unquote Christian nation, because we are not, but because we study the words and the well-being of a prophet and a Messiah named Jesus, who came from a Jewish heritage and an Abrahamic faith, that tried their best for thousands of years to lay down words of truth and righteousness and justice. May we all strive to continue in those aspirations. And may our actions prove it. Sometimes it thinks that helping our neighbor is just giving a quarter to someone on the street. God, it's also understanding how to support our young people who are trying to do their best in school, who are trying to do their best in building a community, knowing that on the other side of that equation is school to jail pipeline. We ask, oh God, that you would take the scourge of fentanyl off our streets, killing not just our celebrities, but killing our very children. One drop, oh God, taking lives over and over and over. And as much as we could wallow in all of this sadness, oh God, may we know that on the Jericho road in which we find ourselves, that there will be people who will try to assail. May we come together as a community and push ourselves through to the other side unscathed, because we are protecting and loving one another. This world we are in, this is the perfect metaphor, is a Jericho road. Those who would do harm to us far out of our eyesight and right around the corner. But we ask that you would bless us and keep us, not because we deserve it, but because we know you can do it and because you promised that you would love us and keep us. So God, we take this prayer of our people, the prayers of the peoples and the prayers of those who are asking for prayer, like the Kilgore family and others who have reached out. And we ask, oh God, that you just touch us with joy no matter what, because your will and your presence is righteous. The divine presence on this world is good. Just help us see it a little bit more. And we will give you praises and sing your songs. And I'll finally get that tambourine and bang on that tambourine in honor of my mother. Bless us all, Jesus. Holy Spirit, guide us, advocate for us, and comfort us. God, we love you, because you are ours, and you, oh God, have claimed us as yours. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, my brothers and sisters, we're going to do something a little new today. Instead of fumbling about how we're going to do our offering, just bring them on down and put them in the plates. Stretch your legs, move around, And maybe some of that blood in your legs will say, "Ooh, I feel something else swishing in my pockets. I can give a little bit more." And those of you who are joining us online, please feel free to go to our website, www.stjamesharlemnyc.org. Scroll down on that first page to donate on the PayPal, with the PayPal button. You're fine. And with the PayPal button, and we'll do that. And you can also mail your offerings to 409 West 141st Street and St. Nicholas Avenue, New York, New York, 64-10031, 64-00. All of these gifts that we receive, including your prayers, your ministries, and your energies, are used for the community of God to be blessed. And we humbly ask your prayers as you send in your offerings, that we may do more than we ever imagined with what we have. We give thanks to you, O God, for all that you have done. We do it with a grateful heart. We give with a grateful heart to the Holy One. We are so grateful for all you've given. And one day may this be so, in Jesus' name. And now let the weak say, "I am strong." Let the poor say, "I am rich," because of what the Lord has done. Thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now our final hymn. We're going to share our screen and move to our final hymn, which sometimes we forget is a spiritual. "Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart." Moses Hogan, the African-American spiritual composer, arranger, has done so many beautiful versions that make us and remind us that this is a prayer. And sometimes we sing this, "Lord, I want." Today, let's sing it as a prayer and hear the words and pray this prayer. Yes, you may move to the next slide. Oh, the one beforehand, sorry. Go back. There we go. No, it's my fault. I did the songs out of order for it, but I did it for a purpose. So, let's sing these words together and pray them. "Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart, in my heart, Lord. In my heart, just beautiful. And now we've come to that time we didn't end early. Let us hear our benediction. The benediction, of course, is not just go on your way. It is a recognition of your blessing, a blessing in ascending. So hear these words. You can go ahead. As we're looking at the final slide, and you're looking at your bulletin cover, you can go two ahead. There's one more, there you are. And as you're looking at your bulletin cover, remember, it doesn't take much to be a good Samaritan. A 17-year-old held up a camera and changed history, changed the notion of what a good Samaritan can be. Loving your neighbor. You know the blessing of caring now. And you know that the blessing of caring makes you the blessing. Go out into the world and share this reciprocal wish. I wish you well, the blessing of caring, and that you know that you are blessed. Take that into the world. Plant it and watch it grow.